morning students, welcome back. How are you all? I hope you all are fit and fine. I'm your SST teacher Maya Gurani. So today, as you all know that we have successfully completed both the chapter, the how, when and where, in the second chapter, from trade to territory, the company establishes through. So in this video, we will be discussing both the chapter together. So this video is going to be a very informative for you, as it will help you in your test. So watch the video till last. How important are dates? Dates are important in history because what is done of those days is of importance. History, it is all about the dates. It is true. Because to remember a particular event like war, succession of throne or death. And it is not true. It is because everything cannot be linked to the dates like drinking tea, British rule or freedom movement. Which dates are important? Dates are important as they note when certain events happen. This is very important because history is recorded chronologically. It helps to know that one event happened before another event so that one can examine the relation between the event. Let's see with the example. As in 1600, East India Company got right to trade with East. In 1651, first English factory was set up. In 1743, Robert Clive came to India for mining lands. In 1756, Aliwardi Khan died and Sirajuddola became the emperor of Bengal. How do we periodize? The periodization of history done by Indian historians or James Mill. According to the James Mill, the periodization of history is divided into Hindu, Muslim or British. According to the Indian historians, the periodization of history is divided into ancient, medieval or modern. As modern period is also known as the colonial. It is because modern period is related to growth of all the forces of modernism. But under the British rule, people were not getting modernized. Therefore, the name changed to colonial period.
So what is colonial? When the subjugation of one country by another leads to these kind of political, economic, social and cultural changes, we refer to the process as a colonization. Now the another question that comes, that what sources do historians use in writing about the last 250 years of Indian history? That is the administration produces record. The British felt that all the important letters and the documents must be carefully preserved. So they set up record rooms attached to administrative institutions, and institutions such as archives and museums were also established for preserving records. Next is, why surveys become important for the British rule? Surveys conducted by the Britishers are an important source of history of the period because the British carried out detailed survey of the various reason and the practices of the people in India during their rule. They surveyed the soil, cropping pattern, flora and fauna. All the facts seen as necessary to know about to administer the reason.
The next topic, that is, what official records do not tell. From this vast corpus of records, we can get to know a lot, but we must remember that these are official records. They tell us the official thought what they were interested in. First, records do not tell what other people in the country felt. Second, only diaries of people, travelers, autographies of the important personalities can tell about literate people. No record of the history is available for the tribals, peasants, workers or the
poor. So, these records do not always help us understand what other people in the country felt and what lay behind their actions. Now, let's revise the second chapter from trade to territory. The company establishes power. As you know that the British originally came as a small trading company, were reluctant to acquire territories. But how then did they come to be master of vast empire? As Aurangzeb was the last powerful Mughal ruler. After the death of Aurangzeb, the last rulers proved to be insufficient. Foreign power got opportunity to establish their rule in India. East India Company comes east. Portuguese were the first European who came to India. Vasco da Gama, a Portuguese explorer, landed in India in 1498. He arrived at Calicut on the Malabar coast. Portuguese establishes their presence in the western coast of India and had their base in Goa. In 1600, Queen Elizabeth I granted the Royal Charter to the East India Company to trade with the East. The East India Company bought goods from Indians at a cheap price and sold them at a much higher price in Europe. The fine qualities of cotton and silk produced in India had a big market in Europe. Spices like pepper, cloves, cardamom and cinnamon were in great demand. All the companies were interested in buying the same things. Competition among the European companies pushed up the prices of goods purchased and this reduced the profits. The only solution the trading companies think of was eliminating their competitors. So what they did, they sank each other's ship, blockade routes and prevented rival ship from moving with the supplies of goods. The desire to secure markets lead to fierce battles between the trading companies. East India Company begins trade in Bengal. The first English factory was set up on the banks of the River Hooghly in 1651. The factory had a warehouse where goods for export were stored. In 1696, the company built a fort around the settlement. 2 years later, the company gained jamidari rights over three villages. One of these was Calicut, which later grew up into the city of Calcutta. The Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb issued an order granting the company the right to trade duty-free. Company persuaded the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb to issue a Farman. Farman means royal order for trade permission. Aurangzeb's Farman had guaranteed only the company the right to trade duty-free. Duty-free means to do trade without paying the tax. The company was not satisfied. They tried to press more concessions and manipulate the existing privileges. The unfair practices of trade gradually led to battles. So now let's discuss how trade led to battles. After the death of Aurangzeb, the Bengal Nawabs asserted their power and autonomy. They refused to grant the company any concessions and stopped it from extending its fortifications. The company was refusing to pay taxes. The conflicts led to confrontations and finally led to the famous Battle of Plassey and Buxar. Battle of Plassey. Ali Wardi Khan died in 1756 and Siraj-ud-Daulah became the Nawab. The company was worried about his power. The company tried to help one of the Siraj-ud-Daulah's rival to become the Nawab. Company promised Mir Jafar the Nawabi title after the death of Siraj-ud-Daulah. Siraj-ud-Daulah ordered the company to stop interfering in his government's affairs, stop fortification, pay taxes. He established control over the company's fort at the Kasim Bazar and Kolkata. On hearing the news, the company officials in Madras sent forces under Robert Clive. In 1757, Robert Clive led the company's army against Rajdhola at Plassey, and he led the company to victory. The main reason for the defeat was that the forces led by Meer Jafar never fought the battle. The Battle of Plassey became famous because it was the first major victory the company won in India. What happened after the Battle of Plassey? Meer Jafar became the Nawab of Bengal. He was just a puppet in the hands of Britishers. When Nawab refused further rights, company replaced him by Meer Qasim. Meer Qasim denied the privilege given to Britishers. This led to Battle of Buxar in 1764 between Britishers and Meer Qasim. British forces were led by Hector Munro. In this battle, British became victorious. Once again, Meer Jafar came to the throne as Nawab of Bengal. When Meer Jafar died in 1765, the company decided of becoming Nawab itself. In 1765, the Mughal Emperor appointed the company as the Diwan of Bengal province, and they also got the Diwani right of Bihar and Orissa. Revenue, a great help for buying cotton and silk and also building forts. Now the Britishers, they got right, the Diwani right, and they asserted themselves as a Nawabs. As the company acquired more power and authority, the company official began to imagine themselves as a Nawabs. They wanted to lead a luxurious life like Nawabs of India. The company official forced the actual Nawabs of Bengal to give land and vast sum of money as personal gifts. Robert Clive had come to Madras from England in 1743. He has appointed as governor of Bengal in 1764 to remove corruption in company administration. He was cross-examined by the British Parliament in 1772 because the Parliament was suspicious of his vast wealth. Finally, he was acquitted from all the charges led against him, but he committed suicide in 1774. However, not all the company officials succeeded in making money like Clive. Many died an early death in India due to disease and war. The official who managed to return with wealth led flashy lives. Now, the British East India Company had a different way of expanding its rule in India. It used a variety of political and economic methods to extend its influence. After the Battle of Buxar, the company appointed residents in Indian states. Who were these residents? The residents were the political agents of the Britishers who served the interest of the company. Through them, the company started interfering in the internal affairs of the Indian states. One such interference was subsidiary alliance. What is this subsidiary alliance? According to this, Indian rulers were not allowed to have their independent armed forces. They had to keep company's army and pay their maintenance. If they failed to do so, the part of their territory was taken away as a penalty by the Britishers. In 1801, the Lord Wolseley forced Nawab of Awadh to give one half of his territory due to the non-payment of maintenance of the British army. So the Hyderabad was annexed by the Britishers by this policy. Now let's discuss the Tipu Sultan. The Sultan was the tiger of the Mysore. The company started facing threat both politically and economically from Mysore. Mysore had grown into a strong state under King Hyder Ali. Tipu Sultan, son of King Hyder Ali, was a very strong ruler in southern Indian state of Mysore. Tipu Sultan ruled Mysore from 1782 to 1799. In 1785, Tipu controlled the trade of Malabar coast and stopped the export of pepper, sandalwood and cardamom from its ports. He also stopped local merchants to deal with the Britishers. Tipu Sultan took the help of French to modernize his army. It was a threat to East India Company. Four wars were fought between the Britishers and Mysore. Anglo-Mysore War. In 1799, the Britishers won the Battle of Srirangpatnam against Mysore and Tipu was killed. Wadiyars become king of Mysore with the condition of subsidiary alliance. After the problem of Mysore was shorted off, a new problem arose, that is the Marathas. War with the Marathas. From the late 18th century, the company was planning to destroy Maratha power. After the defeat of Maratha in Battle of Panipat in 1761, they get divided in various small dynasties. They were held in an alliance under the Peshwa or the principal minister. Three wars were fought between the Maratha and the Britishers. The first Anglo-Maratha war was fought between 1775 to 1782. When the first Anglo-Maratha war was ended in 1782 with the Treaty of Salabai, there was no clear victor. The second Anglo-Maratha war was fought on different fronts, resulting in the British gaining Orissa and the territories north of the Yamuna River, including Agra and Delhi. Finally, the Third Anglo-Maratha War of 1817-19 crushed Maratha's power. British paramountcy in India. Now, the Britishers, under the leadership of Lord Hastings, East India Company initiated a policy of paramountcy. Now, the company claimed that its authority was supreme, hence its power was greater than that of the Indian states. So, in order to become a paramount power, they started annexation of different territories of India. Rani Chennamma was the ruler of a small state of Kittur. When the British tried to annex the Kittur, Rani Chennamma took to arms and led an anti-British resistance movement. She was arrested in 1824 and died in prison in 1829. British also wanted to secure Northwest from French of their empire in India. For this, they fought wars with Afghanistan and Punjab and finally won over its territories in 1843 and 1849 respectively. The new policy the Britishers used to annex the Indian territory, that is the doctrine of Lefs. This policy initiated by the Lord Dalhousie when he was India's Governor General from 1848 to 1856. According to this policy, if an Indian ruler died without a male heir, his kingdom would lapse and would become a part of the company territory. With this policy, the company took control over Satara, Sambalpur, Udaipur, and Jhansi. In 1856, the company also took over Awadh, setting up a new administration. In 1773, Warren Hastings became the Governor General of Bengal. So Hastings divided administration into three presidencies, namely Bombay, Madras, and Bengal. He also codified laws with the help of Hindu pandits and Muslim muftis. Separate civil and criminal courts were set up under the supervision of the collectors and also appointed the collector to collect revenue and maintain law and order. The Britishers, they used the army, the company army. In India, colonial rule brought some new ideas of administration and reform. The Mughal army composed of cavalry and infantry. The army of the Mughal was dominated by cavalry. In the 18th century, changes occurred when Mughal successor states started recruiting peasants into their armies and training them as professional soldiers. The East India Company adopted the same method, which came to be known as the Sepoy. In the early 19th century, the British began to develop a uniform military culture. This created a discontent among Indian soldiers and it became one of the reasons of revolt against Britishers. That's all for this video. Good luck for your test.